So, welcome to this very special May 5th edition of
Tools and Tea Time
with Tim and Rob.
Cheers.
On Tuesdays.
On Tuesdays, lovely. Well, happy May 5th. Happy Cinco de Mayo for those of you that celebrate that. And of course, it is now Teacher Appreciation Week, and it's actually National Teachers Day. Thank you for all that you're doing. We're so happy to be here with you all and to support you in as many ways as we can. We've just enjoyed doing these tea times, and it's just so nice to see we still have people coming, so that's so nice.
We're hearing from people all the time how you inspire us by what you're doing.
Yes. So tea to you. Here's our schedule for today. We're going to highlight a tool that Tim has been keen on trying to put on tea time during our run here. We'll have a community share out with Douglas Watkins, our stalwart virtual background wizard who is not actually going to impress us with a background today, but he'll bring it on when he wants to. He's the high school science curriculum specialist for DPS. And then we'll do, as we always do, a breakout session of discussion based on what we've talked about today. So that's our schedule.
So, Robert, I hear we have a question about a tool this week.
We do. And just a great question. Here it is. We pulled it from our imaginary database of fans again. The Queen decided to take a break from, it was her birthday, actually, the day we did it. But anyways, Rodney says, hey, Tim and Rob, with many of my students making only occasional contact, I want to find a way to get greater student buy-in, agency, and ownership. Got a tool that helps with that? Rodney is so insightful, as Julie says. Yes, he's so insightful. Tim, are you put to the task? Can you find a tool?
Well, Rodney, we went out and I thought of a tool that I learned about a while back, but I got the pleasure of seeing this gentleman, Chris Holman, in Boston back in November, where he talked about it. And for almost 20 years, Chris Holman, shown here, and his associates at the Character Lab at the University of Virginia have been doing research around this question. And the question is, how do students' cultural, religious, family, intellectual, and personal experiences affect their perceptions of learning and their motivation to learn? And his team started out in 2005 to develop a tool called the Build Connections Tool. And they began field testing it to see how students would react with it. And it was based upon research that they had been doing for the previous 10 to 15 years. And so the field testing involved over 500 students and 30 teachers. And it was designed to motivate student learning by making it easier for students to find connections between what they were learning in school and their own personal experiences and interests. They also tried to meet certain requirements that teachers in earlier studies had asked for. They wanted something that would be short and easy to use, printable in black and white, and require little teacher training or support. So in the field test, Chris and associates followed two groups of randomly selected students across the course of a semester. Now, both groups were asked the very same question with very different results. And that question was, how interested are you in the subject that we are currently studying? Now, the question was asked of the students at the beginning in week 2, week 4, week 10, and week 15 of the semester. And the control group that you can see here with the black dotted line were treated normally. In other words, they didn't receive the Build Connections tool. They were just treated as we would normally would. And you can see that they're really interested at the beginning of the semester when asked about the subject that they're learning, but their interest drops off significantly as the semester goes along. But a second group of students, of randomly assigned students, were given the Build Connections tool, which is a short 30-minute activity partway through the semester where they were asked to reflect on what they had been learning and how it might be relevant to their lives. As you can see from the blue line, this second group clearly held on to their interest in the topic. The researchers were confident that the only difference between these two groups of students was that one group had used the reflection tool, the Build Connections tool. Now, this is a really hopeful story tested on real students and by real teachers. And since 2015, you should know that this tool has been refined and used now with over 10,000 students, and the results seem to be consistently reliable and statistically significant. and it indicates that we as teachers can do things during learning that change our students' perceptions and attitudes simply by altering one small part of the learning situation. That part in cognitive education is called salience. And salience is what determines whether your brain's attention networks are going to choose to grab a hold of something that's going on in the learning environment and give it a great influence on your perception of the world and of learning or not. It depends on salience. Now, let's look at the tool itself real briefly, and you'll see that I could not believe the results until I went back because it's so simple. So this is the tool. It's a simple one-page black and white document, and you could adapt this, I think, in some degree to any teaching level. Column one is where you assist students to list or draw their personal interests, their hobbies, and their goals. Now, if you're doing this with real students, a tip is not to insist they fill out the whole column. Maybe they only have four things that they're really interested in life, and as long as they can find a connection, that'll be fine. Column two is where you ask them to list some topics that they are learning about recently in class. And a tip here is that you might have to help them break it down, like point to posters or anchor charts on the wall, word walls. If you have vocabulary, just say, let's generate some vocabulary that we've been using recently. And they put those down in column two. Then in column three at the top, they are asked to quite literally draw lines to connect things from column one, things they're interested in, things that make up the part of their life that they love, and column two, things that you're studying. Now, you and I know that sometimes students are going to struggle to do this, right? Well, section four and five are asking them to develop and think about those connections. And a few tips in this section is, since they don't like to write, they provided sentence frames so that they don't have to you don't just give them a blank page, which is kind of demotivating. So the sentence frames are aiming to help them have a structure for making the connections and developing them. Another tip is to provide a safe environment. Some kids don't want to share with everybody what they're interested in. They maybe think their hobbies are embarrassing or nerdy, so don't force them. But on the other hand, offer an opportunity, and in fact, try to share up on your screen some students who volunteer the connections, because often they find that students sharing their connections help students to see their own connections. They're like, oh, well, I like to skateboard too. I never thought about that connection. And so giving a chance to share is essential. Now, the people who developed this tool have found a few things that are helpful to you when using it. Step one, you're going to need to give a little 3 to 5 minute introduction before you give students a tool, telling them what you're going to do and why you're going to do it. You simply want them to be able to find connections between what you're doing and what they're studying in school, because you want them to find meaning in their everyday life. Number two, you're going to ask them to privately complete the one-page tool, which will take a few minutes, and you're going to need to think flexibly about timing and implementation. So, it could take up to 30 minutes for you to introduce it, have the kids fill it out, and give them time to share with each other and talk about it. But not ever more than 60 minutes. That would be longer than normal. You can implement it early in the unit of study, in the middle, or at the end. It's up to you when you want to do it. Third, students can reflect individually, or you could have them do it in partners or with the entire class. I definitely wouldn't discourage them working on it together, since together they'll find the connections. And finally, this can be done one time if you want, or it can be done multiple times in a semester or a year. But you've seen the results, and you can see that just simply checking in with them seems to have an effect on their motivation to connect. So, Robert, did anybody happen to type any questions in the chat that I should?
Yeah, Julie wanted to know what age groups were tested. Did anybody disaggregate it for age level? You know, did they speak to any types of adjustments at grade level?
Yeah, the studies, I can't speak. I haven't looked recently at what they've been putting up on their website, and we will send that link out again in the website. I know that they were doing primarily middle and high school, but the main findings of the study seem like they would work with a little adaptation in elementary as well, because the main study said that they didn't think it was any particularly brilliant approach other than they were just taking time out of class to take an interest in the students and what they were interested in. A lot of the teachers reported that by doing this, they knew their students on a different level and that they would call out, hey, I know you said you really like bicycles. Guess what we're going to be looking at today? And that the teacher being aware of what the students were interested in and the students perceiving that the teacher was interested in that was what they thought was the key thing that made the difference. So.
I have a couple of comments here. Janelle Johnson, I'm just smiling because this is, Janelle was the first who introduced me to the notion of funds of knowledge, that it's an important connection to make into tapping into that. And then Linda is asking, in terms of a distance environment, is this something that you need to be able to supervise closely, or can you do it in a distance format?
I think you can totally do it in a distance format and then ask students when they return it to you, is it okay if you share a few of their suggestions on the screen? And then you can share some student work samples. And if you're able to do video chat, they could then talk about their connections. And if not, you could read out some of the connections to stimulate thinking in the students who had fewer connections.
And then John Wiley is asking, how can you revisit this without redoing it so you keep the connections fresh in students' minds? One idea I think is just, reflections that you at certain points to just have them, write down and reflect for themselves, that's as far as you go, is just write a reflection.
Yeah, and the study said that they didn't find more success with teachers who did it a lot than if teachers just did it a few times during the year. But I think maybe when you start to see students losing interest, that might be a good time just to, jump in again. Let's take a look again at what you're interested in and some connections between it and what we're studying. So Robert, I'm sure there's lots of good questions. We're gonna give everybody a chance to talk to each other about this, and we can hop into your breakout group as well. But I wanna make sure I don't cut Douglas short. So if it's okay, I think we're gonna move on and give Douglas time to share his thinking as our expert in a similar area. Okay, so let me introduce Doug Watkins. He's the high school curriculum specialist for Denver Public Schools.
Thank you so much, Tim and Rob, for inviting me. I'm super excited to be a part of Tea Time. This is great. And I always love being a part of this CSUN community, so this is a lot of fun. I wanted to build on the ideas that Tim just shared with us about that and that tool for making connections between life and learning, and share with you some of the stuff that we've been doing in the high school realm at DPS, but also through the lens of, to that last question that, who put that up there? I'm gonna lose my spot.
Brandon, maybe? Okay.
Somebody asked a question about how can informal educators use that tool, and I think what I'm about to share, I wanna share through the lens of informal educators being able to measure students' perceptions of whichever perceptions you want to measure so that they're more motivated to want to learn. So in the high school realm, the curriculums that we've developed are built on the backbone that and the theory of learning that if there's a greater sense of coherence, if the learning is more relevant, and if the students feel like they contribute to the knowledge building in the classroom, that they will be more motivated to be in the classroom and will thus learn more. And so those three constructs there are very specific to our curriculums. And I think that's where informal educators can figure out what is it about whatever kind of work that you're designing with or for students that is motivating to them, and what constructs can you come up with to measure after they learn with you if they actually perceived those things. So it's not enough just to measure those things. We want to know, are students actually making the connections? So we did a lot of work about how to create the questions, and then did some cognitive interviews to make sure that students were reading the questions in the ways that we intended them to be read and measured. So Tim, if you're doing the slides, would you mind going to the next slide? And you're there. Great. So the first thing we do is to develop questions. And I know this is a clunky looking slide here, but there are between 4 and 6 questions for every one of those three constructs. And I tried to line up there. Those two sample questions measure a student's sense of coherence between within a lesson sequence. The two middle questions measure a student's perception of relevance, like how relevant is this unit of learning to their lives or to their community. And then also two sample questions for how a student perceives contribution to knowledge building in the classroom, whether they themselves are contributing and if their contributions support learning for all in the classroom. And there's some questions about how other students are contributing as well. Next slide, please. And then, so what we do is, how do we collect those perceptions? We've created within the curriculum these exit tickets. We call them student electronic exit tickets, and they're given at least twice per unit, and they're approximately 18 to 20 questions long. We have some content questions in there too, but the students take their time and answer all those measures for those three constructs. Unlike the Build Connections tool, however, the work here is, from what I understand about that Build Connections tool, and Tim, you can tell me if I'm wrong, the work here is not to have the students gain stronger connections through completing the survey. It's for the teachers and the curriculum developers to gain a better insight into how the instruction is playing out in the room and how the curriculum was developed that leads to a sense of those connections in the classroom. Next slide, please. So what we do is visualize the constructs. And so there are a lot, there's too many to share in a short time here, but I sit down with teachers and I share with them, like, here's the data. And it's broken up by coherence, relevance, and contribution. We break it down a lot of other ways too. The next slide, please. So we sit down with teachers over time. I do this across a semester or across a whole year. And I share with them, like, how have your students perceived the relevance over the course of the year of the curriculum? And embedded in that whole, well, I'll get to that in a second. If you could go to the next slide. We also break it down by race and gender and other identities, because one of the stated goals for our curriculums that we're designing at the high school level is that a student's sense of contribution, coherence, and relevance cannot be predicted by their race or their gender. So in order to make that happen, we break down all the data by a lot of different demographical and identity-based constructs. And then I sit with teachers on that next slide. I sit with teachers in an ongoing PDSA cycle. We like study the data, we make a plan. I come in and observe them doing the plan. We study how they did the plan, and then we act on that. You know, it gets this huge cycle of ongoing work. If indeed the teacher thinks that there are curricular moves that could be made to increase a student's sense of coherence, relevance, or contribution, then we focus on those. Otherwise, if I feel like the teacher is using all the tools that the curriculum is giving them and students are still not sensing coherence, relevance, or contribution, then I take that back to the curriculum development table and try to figure out how can we adjust the curriculum itself. And that's where I think the informal educators could use something similar to this. If you're able to measure the motivational properties of whatever system of learning that you're engaging students with, and you can take that data and look to see, like, how, in two ways. One was that, was the informal educational opportunity delivered in the way that was intended? And if so, maybe we need to go back to the drawing table and reconstruct this informal education opportunity. Otherwise, maybe it's a good window into how the opportunity was delivered if the students don't perceive the motivation that you were hoping for. Next slide is just, again, it all comes back to motivation in order to ultimately increase student motivations. And like, why is that? Next slide. is because perception, motivation, and learning are all tied together. And I was so excited when I saw that this was the tool that was going on this week. So I was like, I can just tie this right into a nice big bow. So I thank you again, Tim and Rob. I felt like these things were really overlapping.
We tried. Yeah, Douglas. Slick tie back there at the end. Yeah, I liked it. And, you know, I think teachers out there, a lot of you like me might think, you know, but all this stuff takes time. You know, like I remember when we were supposed to start incorporating more movement in class and you're thinking, yeah, but if we take 5 minutes to move, then we're going to lose 5 minutes of science or reading or whatever. And I think that the thing we forget in education, because we have these weird brains we're carrying around, these animal brains, that what's efficient is not always effective. That, yeah, you can do away with checking in with students and getting them to move, but then the salience isn't there. They don't see the connection. They don't learn anything. And what's the point if they don't learn anything, right? So, yeah. Okay, well, I don't want to take up your talk time. So, Robert, should we move on?
Yeah, and there's questions about getting your questions that you've got listed there, Douglas. We'll make sure that's available. Here's the community check-in. We don't have a whole lot of time, so I'm going to break you out into groups. The question on the table is, how could you check in with your students more to enhance learning? Think about relevance, think about contribution, think about connectedness. And to Douglas's point, for those of you in the informal community, this is something we can still attend to, even if it's just a slight brush of understanding what that is. I'm going to post the question out on the chat. I'm going to break you out into rooms. We're going to have about 6 minutes to have a conversation. Let's hear from group 12, John or Richard. Get on the mic there and tell us what you were talking about.
Hi. We talked about the fact that all of the early work is sometimes sacrificed for efficiency, like Tim said, how you build coherence and relevance in your classroom. But then we came back to and wrapped up with the thought of using those exit tickets and keeping them really, really simple, like yes, no, because you get instantaneous data that you can graph and chart and like, and it's not open-ended, so there may be some details lost, but yes or no is like really clean and effective.
Nice. Thank you so much. How about group 11, Adrian and Beth and Christine? Somebody want to get on the mic and share?
Well, we pressed for time, but we definitely talked about how PBL, it's already built in, the relevancy and the connection to kids' personal lives, and that PBL is the way to go, just because it's already there. So we also got kind of sidetracked into my personal frustration in that elementary schools have so many crunches on their time that it's sometimes hard to fit science in. And as a mom, it was hard for me to, when my son was in third grade last year, that he had one trimester of science. It about killed me. So there are so many crunches on elementary schools and the time and skills, while I'm sitting up in my high horse of middle school thinking that it's the way to fit everything in, I realize that it's not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's some difficulties there. I do want to background, there was questions about, you know, using the tool that Tim introduced, and Tim wasn't sure about the copyright, but, you know, it's a tool that you can modify for yourself and to your purposes. So to that end, in terms of copyright, you know, it's probably best to just make your own version if that's what you're having to consider.
And I think the big takeaway here is to check on those aspects that Douglas talked about, those three aspects with your students, check in with them on a regular basis. John Hattie's effect sizes, all the ones that really affect learning the most, a lot of those have to do with interpersonal relationships between teacher and student and teacher and teacher. The idea that you're checking in with each other has a huge ability to impact not only the social emotional life of the student, but also their cognitive development. Like they really do grow more than one grade level when they think you're thinking about how they're connecting. So I think it's a big takeaway for the day.
And last but not least, we still have out to for grabs, the online folder of wonder has this lovely tea infuser thingy. The gorilla didn't get an owner from last time. So you know what? We're going to look and find another. Gosh darn it. Stay with us while I figure out how I'm doing, what the heck I'm doing on Zoom. Oh, and meanwhile, look at that. Gosh, that's amazing. Look at all the resources there. Why can't I stop sharing? There we go. Okay, let me get back on here. Oh,
who will be? Who's going to win the TMBuser?
I almost canceled the recording. I'm so excited. Okay.
And move on to their their next beverage of choice.
This is not, okay, slice, not use. Oh, I'm clicking on the wrong button.
Oh, there we go. You're getting
okay. You only have 2 minutes left. I'm going to wheel of names.
Watch for your name.
You're all in here. You're all eligible. Who's going to win the TV user? Who is it going to be?
Does it stop?
Douglas!
Oh, Robert could see it before us. I'm Douglas!
Well, that was not rigged. That was not planned. Douglas, you are our winner. We will send it over to you.
That was not rigged.
It's
and he
not
does
rigged,
come every week, Douglas. So he's been waiting. He's been waiting for his day.
Okay, so Douglas is our winner of the Gorilla Tea Infuser. I just want to point out that we will be back next week. See you next Tuesday. We actually have a program featuring some teachers that are doing some interesting things with Google Classroom. I think you want to stay for that one. So do not pay attention to the slides not used this week because they will not be used. And thank you so much for joining us for tea time.
Thanks for joining this very professional operation.
Yes. Yes.
We appreciate every one of you.
To you. Thank
Enjoy
you so
your
much,
evening.
Everybody.
Enjoy your evening. Thanks for coming.
Bye, everybody.
Come for tea, stay for Google Classroom. I love it. Bye.